Welcome to the Show Up Show, where we bring you everything you need to emerge as a powerful and healthy leader in your life, business, and relationships. Because how you show up in one area of life is how you show up in all of them. I'm your host, Debbie Pace, author of The Journal to Freedom, a foundational guide to help you examine your beliefs and how they shape your patterns and behaviors in life, so you can transform what's not working and can show up like a boss in every area of your life. How do you mix meditation, concrete, and art? Find out this week on the Show Up Show as we talk to Neil Aronowitz, a construction firm owner who talks about how he reinvented himself through concrete and the spiritual process and vulnerability in every piece. Plus, his art is so good, they made a movie about it. Tune in now and check it out. Neil, you and I we're in a group together, and I've really had the pleasure of seeing how you're showing your work. You have, there is a documentary on your process. Tell us a little bit about you, what you do, and a little bit about your art too.
Well, I make very highly sculptural furniture and lighting. And I've been doing artwork all my life, but mostly as a hobby. I went to art school, and then I had kids in my late 20s, and that put everything on hold. So to bring home the bacon, I've had a construction company for about 30 years or so. And I was always making pieces on the side, and I had dozens of sketchbooks filled up with the fantasy furniture. And I don't think I ever really thought seriously I would do it. And then fast forward, I was involved in a clean energy startup for 5 years with some partners. We ran out of money, and I was looking for my next act, and I created an organic sprouted food bar. And I was about to go to market, and I was shocked that one of the biggest health food stores on the West Coast of the U.S. wanted it in all their stores, which is a really rare thing. And to my shock, the thought that came to my head is, oh my God, if I do this, I'll never do design work. And I never even had that thought before in my life. So I said, all right, well, I've got to go with this, you know. So I put that whole food bar venture on the shelf. And then, you know, it seemed like a magical process, because a few days later, I saw a poster for a biannual design show in Portland for furniture and lighting. And I'd heard about this show, and I always thought, you know, I'd love to be able to enter something. So I thought, okay, I'll give it a shot. If I don't do it now, I'm never going to do it. So I came up with a design, and it got in. It was very innovative, as it turns out. And it's with a material that nobody has really used very much, called concrete canvas. And it got incredible press. I was in blogs internationally, and I was picked up by some magazines and some design websites. And it had a life of its own, and it began to be a wave that just kept growing and growing and growing, to my astonishment. And then I heard about international lighting competition in Vancouver, British Columbia. And so I came up with a design for my first chandelier, and I made a prototype out of plastic tube. And I photographed it and photoshopped it to make it look like a fancy glass chandelier. I entered it in the contest, and they called me up. They said I got second prize. Okay. Now I had to make it. So
that's a good problem to have, right?
Yeah. So it's been interesting. And I just kept on entering contests and winning. And I got spoiled in a way. It started out like it was so easy, and everything has been flowing. So that's how it started. And I'm still doing my construction company. I'm not full-time at it yet. I'm really kind of at the tipping point. So it's a very busy day between, you know, running my company with 6 employees and going to the studio. I'm up at 4 in the morning and in bed at 10 o'clock. And it's a full day, but I'm so passionate about it. I just, you know, there's not enough time in the day. I wake up, you know, super excited and totally full of energy. I've never had so much energy in my life. So, you know, I'm just, you know, the passion is just running through me right now. So that's the beginning. That's how it all started.
So what's really interesting is, on the outside, you're a very successful artist. You're making sales, which is one of the biggest problems with entrepreneurs, is actually making the sale. And you still have a full-time, I like to use the word side gig and full-time gig. So you have your own company still full-time, But yet you, 7 years ago, you decided to pursue your passion. So you've been doing both for 7 years. What's the cutoff point for you? What are you waiting for?
Well, it comes down to money, really. I've had a great year. I've had my most sales this year. And then coronavirus hit and everything stopped for a couple of months. And then I had my best month after that. You know, I got the highest price I ever got for one of my pieces. So I could actually for the first time, I could see if this continues, then I could give up the construction company. So it's a matter of numbers and getting the work out there. And I've had incredible highs. You know, I had the actress Kate Blanchett found my work online and had her designer call me. I sold her a piece for her home in England. So that was that was a huge thrill. And then, you know, you get these great highs and these great lows. I just sold a chandelier about a month ago from the highest price I ever got. The check arrived. And then I got a call that they canceled it. So I have like these great highs and lows, and it's, you know, I have to kind of just stay balanced in the middle of it all. But it's, you know, it's really exciting. These incredible openings keep on happening, and I'm kind of following the trail. It almost seems like it's out of my control. I just have to put in as much work as possible. You know, the sales are continually increasing, and I'm looking for that tipping point where the artwork actually pays my nut, and it's getting extremely close to that. And you know, the challenge is that the market that I am in is like the real high art market. You know, I'm not selling to IKEA or places like that. It's you know, like the 1% of the 1% are buying this, and because it's very expensive, it's $10,000 plus for most of my pieces. And a lot of the art market is based upon perceived value. So, you know, some of the pieces that I'll sell for $10,000 could sell for $50,000. So it's an interesting world to kind of break into. And it's got its own challenges economically and also aesthetically and reputationally. I've had some big wins. Like I was interviewed by one of the biggest design critics in New York on her YouTube channel. So that was a huge high. And then one of the top design writers has a book coming out and wanted to feature me in the book. And, you know, that was all set to go. And then inconveniently, she passed away a couple of months ago.
Oh my goodness.
So yeah, it's just, you know, thrills, chills, and you know, highs, lows. And, you know, so far it's been working out. And like I said, there's a force at work that's bigger than me at this point. So I'm just following the trails.
That's also why I think it's so important. We hear so often in business that you really have to follow your passion, that if you're following your passion, the rest is easy. Or if you're just following the money, then it's hard to sustain really any kind of business if you're doing it for the money. So I love how you really talk about keeping your passion while also keeping the thing that's paying the bills. And obviously you have employees as well, so their welfare, their livelihood is a concern of yours too. You know, it was really neat, Neil. I got to see the documentary that was done on your process. And when you talk about your art being upwards of $10,000, one of the things that I was thinking about, which you answered the question in the documentary, was you're bending concrete. And the documentary is it 108 ways to bend concrete? So there's a lot of work involved. And I couldn't help but wonder you must absolutely pass out at the end of the day working with that heavy concrete all day. But I had questions about the documentary when you were talking about it takes about 125 hours to do a piece. That's a lot of labor and a lot of heavy, heavy labor. So how do you keep yourself in the game sometimes when maybe you don't feel like lifting another lump of concrete, right? Because that's how it starts out, as this big slab of dry concrete that you have to do this whole process to.
Well, first of all, I want to go back to you. You said something very insightful about the money. You know, when I got into this, I made a decision to myself that I'm only going to make pieces that interest me. I'm not going to try to do it for the money, because it was, you know, when I heard that calling, it's like, if I do the food, I won't be able to do the design work. It was all about just doing things I'm interested in. So it's actually a constant battle in coming up with new pieces, not to think, I mean, money's a reality, of course, but to not let it compromise the vision of the design. So that's always a constant back and forth. I'm working on something right now, and it's oddly similar to pieces that other people have done. So do I abandon it, or do I just stay with my own little vision of it. So it's a real challenge just to stay internally driven rather than, you know, market driven.
And even to walk away from a company that was ready to skyrocket. I mean, food is hard. I've had food. Food is hard, a hard business. So to get to that point, that must have been that moment in life where you said, I'm either going to do it now or it's probably never going to happen.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Now, what was your second question? I sidetracked myself before.
I guess the part about how do you.
The end of the day. Yeah. Well, you know, it's actually a very lightweight concrete. So physically it is physically challenging. It's not backbreaking, but it's the interesting thing is, about 80% of it is kind of grunt work. It's, you know, you don't really see the finish, and the reward is like the last 20% when the finish starts to come alive. And I call it the goosebumps phase where it's just, man, it just feels so good. And sparkle.
Something you said in the documentary, which I want to have, I want to make sure the audience knows where to find that before we get off of here. But one of the things that you said in the documentary was that you get this feeling when you're talking about the goosebumps, and when you get this sense, each time you look at a piece, you can tell, you get an internal response, that some gut response basically that's telling you this is definitely a good one. Can you share that?
Yeah, it's a very interesting experience because, you know, there's a scene in the first Star Wars that I kind of liken my process to where Luke is trying to destroy the Death Star. So he's following the computer, and the computer is trying to guide, the computer guidance system is he's using that. And then all of a sudden, Obi-Wan says, Luke, trust the Force. He's urging him to like cut off the computer. And so Luke cuts off the computer and his intuition just takes him there. And he always says, always trust the Force. And I always find there's moments where I'm manipulating the piece and my mind can't figure it out. And it's that moment where I just have to trust, let it go. And it somehow it always works out. So that's a really interesting process.
And just watching the documentary was so insightful for me, just understanding that one, albeit unique and absolutely beautiful piece of furniture, just has so many different processes to it. And you have to have such vision going in from that concrete composite sheet to what your whole vision is, plus colors and all these things. Or does it come to you during the process?
It's a little bit of both. I have found that my project management skills in construction have carried over because you're balancing a lot of steps, you know, leading to a final result. So I'm able to organize the process, but there's every piece, there's something different and there's always some kind of problem. And I'm in one right now, I'm making another table and there's something I overlooked. And that's what's really so great about it is, you've never mastered it. I get better and better at it, but you know, it's planning, but the power of a piece comes in the surprises. And then each one is different. And, you know, I sometimes I think it's a disaster and then it comes out great. I ship it and I think, oh, they're going to hate it. and then I get a call and, you know, it's like, they love it. And it's just, oh, it feels so good. And then finish answering your question, I love the process of working. So even during the grunt work phase, I've got podcasts going, music going, and you know, I'm learning while I'm doing that, you know, that hard work. So I'm just as happy as a clam alone in my studio doing, you know, every step of the way. And then, you know, the process where it gets delivered to somebody and, you know, or it's in a magazine, that's more of the fun.
So you have, I think I read that you had, it was 2 out of 100 pieces make it through?
Well, I was saying like I have like 100 designs and then, you know, one will actually pass muster. I'll think, yeah, this is worth doing. You know, so it's like there are so many ideas that you know, you can come up with. And I've talked with the filmmaker about this too, because he had, you know, dozens of hours of footage and he turned it into a 20-minute film. So there's so many stories that you can tell out of, you know, 14 hours of film narrowed down to 20 minutes. I mean, there's hundreds of stories. And it's the same thing with a piece, you know, or trying to generate pieces. Different pieces tell different stories. They're solving different problems. They're expressing different parts of who I am. And, you know, when I am going to be making something, it's a huge commitment because it turns into hundreds of hours of planning. And so, you know, if I'm going to pick something to work on, I darn well better be sure that I'm passionate about it and that it's going to be have some power to it.
Can you tell us a little bit about your pieces? Because we haven't really talked about, we know you're an artist and you make furniture, right? Some tables. Tell us a little bit about your furniture. What pieces do you make? What is the part of your personality that comes into each piece? Because I think that is really what sets the art apart.
Yeah, it's a great question. I've always been attracted to organic architecture specifically. I was first inspired by the work of Frank Lloyd Wright, which is his forms are informed by nature, and you know, biomorphic sculpture, more like very natural kind and very fluid and spirals and these kind of universal natural forms. So that's sort of, it's very sculptural, the work I do. It's very free form. It's almost abstract. It's like the very edge of function. It's functional, but just barely.
True.
And people look at it and they go, how did he do that? So that's because, and that's really, I look at it like, how did I do it? I do these complicated pieces, not by planning, because those are the things that interest me. And I kind of stumbled on this material called concrete canvas, which is only about 10 years old. It was developed in England, and it's got a very interesting history and use, which probably not enough time to get into it now. But I hadn't even realized how innovative it is until I was interviewed by this design historian in New York. And she wanted to interview me and talk about the table. And I told her, I do other things besides concrete canvas. And she said, that's why you were invited on the show. that's your contribution to design. And I'm thinking, oh, okay, that's interesting. And she put it in a context that the material I'm using is actually a unique contribution to the history of design, not to kind of get too grandiose about it, but it she made me realize that there is a kind of a unique thing that's worth exploring. And she encouraged me to explore it. And I was talking to a gallery about showing it in their gallery. And I said, I don't want to be just pigeonholed as the concrete canvas guy. And the gallery owner says, believe me, you want to be pigeonholed as a concrete canvas.
It's funny because everyone's told to niche and you're sitting here saying, no, I don't want a niche. I don't want a niche. But everybody's telling you, no, you're already in it.
Yeah. But from a marketing point of view, people need something to grab onto. So it's worth exploring. And then the chandelier that I made, there's really nothing like it. It's just, it expresses sort of an explosive energy. It just interested me. And then I did a sconce that based on the phases of the moon. So I don't quite know how I come up with, I'm discovering what my interests are as I do it, because I'm looking back on it, I see, oh, okay, there's a common theme here. So I'm only 6 years into it. So I'm still discovering my own vision as an artist. Yeah, that's what really makes it fascinating for me. Like they say, sometimes writers write to know, to discover what they think about. And I'm making pieces to see what I feel about, how I feel about things.
Wow, that's beautiful. And what a process too. What's really great is that you're already working in the concrete industry. So you likely have access to products and I don't even know what the word I'm looking for.
Yeah, there are materials and processes that have carried over. And I'm training an assistant right now to help me, but I'm realizing 25 years of skills are really hard to transfer over. But I think aside from technical skills, the biggest, most important skill is just to, as a project manager, you just get the job done no matter what. And it's that, perseverance and, even in the midst of not knowing what the hell's going on, you just keep going and pushing through and keeping focus. So, yeah, there's a whole range of skill sets from material selection to, hand-eye coordination and skills that have carried over and I've continued to develop. Not to mention the business side as well, like knowing how to interact with, with the market, with gallerists and internet websites. So
sometimes you don't even know what the process is going to look like at the end. And I was thinking while I was watching the documentary about how much faith it must require for you, because you, I mean, each, you said each piece cost $500 each just for the canvas.
When all is said and done, it's a little under $1,000 worth of materials.
Yes, which is a large amount to put out for something that may not make it past the wet stage. And I was thinking about not only the amount of faith that you have to have in yourself, in the process, but also you mentioned that you had sort like an imposter syndrome each time it comes through. You're just, you know, am I really this, or, you know, am I just trying to pretend to be something? And can you talk a little bit about how you overcome that?
I'm still trying to overcome it. You know, I think it takes a certain amount of you know, if you're taking a risk, you know, you're putting yourself out there. So I've definitely got more confidence than I've had before, but. You know, to this day, I ship a piece out and I'm, you know, I'm just like scared that they won't like it, you know, or I'll be in a show and I'll just think, oh, everybody's, this is just going to look so trivial. You know, they're just going to laugh at me. It's like, you know, I was trying to make a piece and I was having trouble finishing it for an exhibition. And there was a film crew doing for a newspaper doing interviews with some of the artists, and they wanted to interview me, and I didn't know if I could finish my piece, and I just thinking, oh man, they're just going to come and they're going to think I'm a fraud. And it was, the funny thing is, they came to the, finally I let them in like 2 days before the show, and they looked at my piece and they said, wow, you're further along than most people.
So sometimes not knowing what everyone else is doing can be a good thing.
Yeah, exactly. I kind of feel like if you're not scared, you're really not, you know, taking enough risks, you know. And I've been doing this work because I feel passionate about it. And I think by definition, if you're not at the edge with your artwork, you're not pushing yourself. Yeah, I've come to embrace that. I mean, I definitely have more confidence now because I've sold quite a few pieces, and you know, my price keeps going up, and I've gotten great press. And but you know, to this day, that's like, you know, am I going to look like a fool?
Yeah, I've seen your art. I mean, I've seen your art. It's absolutely beautiful. And you were talking a little bit about vulnerability, feeling a little bit vulnerable throughout the process, and there's 108 ways to bend it. There are obviously a lot of ways and times that the entire product can basically be ruined or broken or whatever.
Yes, and I'm in that right now. I've got a piece that's about 3/4 done, and I just made a stupid mistake. I could see what I did, and I should have known better. And I haven't been in the studio in 4 days because I've kind of wanted to sort of let this settle down. And I was just in the studio about an hour and a half ago, and I see what I have to do. It's going to take me about 10 hours to fix, but this is where all the learning comes in. I mean, I was feeling super confident because I was like 20 hours ahead of my process. I think, oh man, I'm starting to really nail this. So the, you know, that's the kiss of death when you get too confident. So this is where the humility comes in, and the vulnerability and the stick-to-itiveness. So it really has to bring out the best in me, you know, to not get discouraged about it. All right, it's not a disaster. It's just a challenge. Just push through it.
So such inspiring and a really deep story, honestly, about following your passion, about allowing it to take a form of its own, and really trust and faith, because there's so much blind faith required in your process.
Yes.
Is there anything that you would like our listeners to know about your own process, your inner process? You talked about each piece is an internal experience. And can you just share anything that you think might help? We have a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of business owners, people working through some of their own inner stuff who listen to the show. So is there anything that you can share with us that you think is a good nugget?
You know, I've been on a spiritual path for about 30 years. The path is Vedanta, which is based on the philosophy in India. So I've been meditating for, you know, 30 years, and I teach classes on the Bhagavad Gita and the Upanishads. So it's a big part of my life, and it's a part of who I am. And it's come up, I've kind of seen how it's informed my work in a sense that, you know, you're not the doer. You know, we're like a machine, and then the operator is some spirit. And, you know, I sort of have to get out of the way. and let, you know, let that spirit work through me. And then there's non-attachment, like don't be attached to the product and to the result. You just do the best you can. In fact, one of the teachings in the Bhagavad Gita is you have the right to the work, but not to the fruits of the work. So I don't worry too much about my career. You know, I try to do the best I can, and it's got to be the whole process is where the focus has to be. And then the rest takes care of itself. So the, and then there's letting go of the piece. It's not mine. You know, it's out there, and you know, whatever happens to it, it happens to it. It's like sending your kid to college. It's just like, okay, you're on your own. I've done my job. You know, live your life now.
Yeah.
So I'd say non-attachment in the process, definitely focus, because you can't, you know, your mind has to be disciplined. And so, you know, a certain amount of training, and any entrepreneur knows this, that, you know, you've got to really prioritize your time. You have to focus on your time. So concentration and mental discipline and discipline in your behaviors is a spiritual process. And that, you know, mindfulness comes in. Like I could see the result of my lack of mindfulness and the problem I have right now. So it's all a teaching. And if you look at it as a teaching, you know, then that's when work becomes worship. And yeah, that's what I've been trying to do. And I think that's the highest vision of work that we can have, no matter what type of work we're doing.
And each piece that you do has its own element of spiritual in it, of flow, of whatever you were bringing through, whatever was coming through you at that time to become that piece of art. And so they're just beautiful. Where can people find your work? Where can they go to see it?
It's really, I mean, they're all in private homes right now, but definitely on social media. I'm on Instagram, you know, neil.aronowitz, neil.aronowitz. I'm on Facebook as well. And my website, www.neilaronowitz.com. The film is still on the film festival circuit. Actually, it's been winning the best documentary. It actually just won at the London International Film Festival, best documentary out of 60 films, and it's won awards all over the place. So while it's still on the film festival circuit, the director cannot release it yet. But it is available to educators. If there's any art educators, you can contact the director or through me. And that's available for educational purposes. You know, people can follow me on Instagram or Facebook, and I'll be making announcements when it is available. So I'm well represented on social media, and you just Google my name as well. There's a lot to be seen.
Awesome. And I guess if someone is interested in a piece, then they just reach out to you directly. And
yes, exactly.
Follow the links and follow where to contact you. Perfect. Neil, thank you so much for joining us today and sharing your story. Your vulnerability through your artwork is such an amazing story. So we just appreciate you coming on. And if our listeners really want to get in touch with you, I'm sure you'll be hearing from them soon.
Great. It was great to talk to you, Debbie. Thanks.
If you like what you're hearing on the Show Up Show, be sure to subscribe. And if you really, really, really like it, please leave a 5-star review. If you'd like to connect with the Show Up Show on social media, you can find us on Facebook at The Show Up Show Podcast or on Twitter at The Show Up Show. Let's be sure to connect over on the other side. Thanks for listening.